Now we are approaching the Q&A session. I hope that all the presenters are available. So we got below 50 in the audience. And obviously, my president, Madam Gurunath, is still there. So hopefully, we could have an active discussion. So it's open to the audience to raise questions, and speakers would be able to answer. So I think it's good if we can make a broader question so all the audience can benefit from that.
Yeah, my name is Kaushal, and I'm actually joining from Japan. I think it's very important, you know, topic, and it's really interesting. I joined from the beginning to the end, despite of being a, you know, the weekend. In fact, you know, when I listened to the, you know, the presenters, actually a lot of good ideas came in. So I would like to, you know, share a little bit about, you know, the Japan policy and how Japan reduced traffic accidents. So just want to, you know, briefly, you know, point out that. So in 1970s, in fact, Japan also had very similar level of traffic accidents compared to Sri Lanka. And then they came up with this 3E approach. So 3Es are, one is about the engineering. Most of the, you know, the speakers today talk about how we can use the engineering the technologies to improve the, you know, the road safety. And the other one is the enforcement. The third point, enforcement is basically law and order. And the third point is actually about education. Now, being a Sri Lankan and living in Japan for a long time, what I see is what we are missing in Sri Lanka is mostly about that education part. Because our roads and vehicles are actually, even compared to Japan, is no much difference. But our, you know, Dilanta, you know, explained the point that our driving schools and our drivers are actually not you know, eligible to drive on the road mostly, especially when it comes to the professional drivers, because when they do some mistake, it's actually affected not only the driver, but also the passengers as well. So I think we need to have a proper program to assess the driver's aptitude, you know, both the physical and also psychological, for them to see whether they are really, you know, in a position to, you know, drive on the roads, especially professional drivers. And the other one is actually this using the simulators kind of thing. I think that is very important, because in Japan, they usually train through a simulator, and then, you know, they learn the vehicle, you know, how to they put the seat belts, and then how to operate these signals, steering wheels, everything they train in the simulator before they actually go into the real roads. So I think that part is something we need to look at. Engineering and enforcement also very important, but education part is something that I feel as a Sri Lankan being in Japan for a long time is missing. So if you know, this you know, committee and the experts can think about that, I think it's really important point. So this is the point that I want to mention to the expert panel. Thank you.
Thank you, Kaushal, for start rolling the board. Any comments from our speakers?
Yeah, this is Krishnan from World Bank. I just want to comment. I mean, education is important, but I think the broader point is the education, just education will not help. It is, this also has been proven in Western countries. Now, I will give you a simple example. As people in our countries, we go abroad and we follow all the rules. Now, the only reason we follow all the rules is because of two things. Because the infrastructure in the advanced countries will not allow the wrong behavior, first. Second is, if somebody does the wrong behavior, then there is strict enforcement. So the behavior is a function of your infrastructure and the enforcement. You cannot change people's behavior by actors saying things or by public, personalities, going on TV and saying things. It is just impossible without having the right infrastructure. And if the infrastructure that is going to allow the right behavior, this is the very key point. If the infrastructure does not allow the right behavior, then your 50% of the problem is solved. The other 30% of the problem is by enforcement. Education is a minor aspect that will come later on. It is not going to solve your problem. It is not going to solve any problem. I'll give you another analogy. If you build a staircase without a handrail, and then you ask people to come down the stairs, people are going to fall. This is what is happening across our region, where we are building roads without crash barriers. Now, if you build roads without crash barriers, and then you say it is a driver's fault, it is wrong. It is simply not tenable. So the first step is to build the right infrastructure. Second step is you have enforcement, strict enforcement. Third, yes, you need to educate. That education has to come before you issue the license. So don't issue licenses to people who do not know the signs and who do not know the rules. So that is where your education has to come in. Education by itself is zero, will not solve anything. Even I can give you reports from World Bank, from a very recent report which says just education without any of these other things is useless. It is not going to solve any problems. I will just stop at that.
Yeah, just to comment on that. In fact, even in the University of Morotu, who has done a research on this one, 90% of Sri Lankan traffic accidents happen due to the human errors. So if the training is not there, even we have the infrastructure, if the drivers are not really, able to drive, so that is the biggest problem in Sri Lanka, according to, statistics, research done by University of Morotu, what I have read. So, and the other thing, that the psychological behavior, yes, I agree that, behavioral change is not possible, but at least the person knows that I have some problems, because, the when you drive, it's a kind of decision-making process. You see your object, and then you make your brain decision, and then you apply the, brakes. And this behavior actually has a, different timing. Person to person, it varies. So the person need to really understand about, whether their decision-making timing is actually right or wrong. So that is why, and also if you look at Sri Lankan traffic, most of the traffic, second largest traffic accidents is actually pedestrians. Why it happens? Because our drivers actually look at only right-hand side when they drive, and they usually don't look at the left-hand side. And those kind of things, are the things that we need to measure when really look at the driver's aptitude. So infrastructure is important and enforcement is important. Of course, I know, but this is something that missing, and most of the developing countries have not checked that. So this is the comment that I want to make. Thank you.
Thank you, Kaushal. And both of you are correct. I think we have to strike a balance, but both these aspects are important. I can see a lot of comments in the chat, and we got many recruits join as well. Professor Jayasingha, Professor Arjun Alvihari, and many others are there in the audience. So any comments or queries to the speakers?
Can I come in? Professor Arjun Jayasingha here.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yeah, I think we have to take a more systems approach, because as medical people, we tend to focus on individuals and problems in relation to individual drivers and them making mistakes. But I think an accident happens due to several factors which are operative at that particular moment. It could be related to the driver's reflexes, but at the same time, several environmental factors come into operation. For example, again, if you look at the at a particular point, which are hotspots, and Kirti, we've been discussing about this also, the hotspot could have environmental factors such as glare, lack of, in the nights, you see the crossings, most of them are ill-lit. Some of the crossings are just after a hump. Then in some of the places, you don't have adequate lanes being shown on the for the drivers. So it's a multifactorial thing which ultimately leads to an accident. It's not just a driver who is drunk who goes and has an accident, because that same driver who is drunk might not have an accident in another place because the environment was better or more conducive to his slow reflexes. So I think we have to look at it from a systems point of view. And I quite agree with the previous observations. I mean, if you don't have pavements, you're going to have you're going to have pedestrian deaths. And if you go around Sri Lanka, just after any of the towns, some of the towns themselves don't have pavements. And we seem to think that drawing a white line on the road is a pavement. And I think more than 95% of our roads have no pavements. And then to blame the accidents on only the drivers, I think is that's not going to solve the issue. So my plea is that we look at it from a more systems perspective, look at the environmental factors, which can easily be modified. You know, training drivers to drive well is a different ball game that is going to take another 1 year. But if you're really, if we identify the hotspots, find out the factors which are there in the hotspots, make minor changes to those areas, I think there'll be success. So thank you very much.
Can I, chairperson, can I make a comment?
Yes, please go ahead.
I'm Upul Senarat, professor in community medicine, Colombo faculty. When I sort of listened to the national strategic plan, the target 10% reduction in mortality or the number of deaths in 5 years or 10 years may not be adequate. If we are serious, now we all understood that this is not an emergency, even a crisis, and this is the number one public health problem. But the attention on this problem is less compared to the other issues in the country. Therefore, I think if you look at the size of the problem and its impact, it is enormous. And only very few people, I think, talk about this problem compared to the other public health issues. Therefore, I suggest there should be some sort of a wider engagement of the stakeholders and also higher level of political support, especially if you are serious about it. This 10% reduction, I think we should have a higher target, because 10% reduction of deaths may not have any impact on the population, any impact on the health of the people or the social aspects. Therefore, please have a higher target so that you have to get the higher level political support in order to implement these activities. And I quite agree, and all the spokesmen I think mentioned about the strict enforcement of law. There are many lapses and gaps, violation. I mean, at every accident or every incident, there's breaching of regulations. So therefore, despite the road condition, despite the vehicle condition, right, there is some degree of violation of regulations. Therefore, enforcement is a must. If you want to even sustain a behavior, we have to keep the enforcement, strict enforcement over a period of time so that the behaviors will be institutionalized, at least in the next generation. Education is important, but without enforcement, nothing will happen in this country. This is my experience as a public health expert. So we have to have enforcement, but parallelly, the education and other things, I think these were mentioned repeatedly, but the effort by our professionals or stakeholders or even political commitment towards this at the moment is inadequate, because we have been talking this from 2015 under Sustainable Development Goals to reduce the number of deaths by 50%. Now 5 years have gone, 6 years, but hardly any improvement, rather deterioration of the situation. So even at this moment, even though we are late, I think we have to make very, I think, intensive effort with a lot of commitment. Thank you. My comments are over.
Thank you for those comments, and thank you, Professor Jaisingh, for your comments as well.
Yeah, can I come in?
Yeah, auditor, I think you are writing a lot to chat.
That's right. So I'm from UK. I'm a medic from UK. I feel that it is absolutely paramount to educate the masses. If you take 100 drivers and ask them whether they should stop at a pedestrian crossing, most of them will say no. They might say that, you know, they should drive on. So it is absolutely paramount to how to simple messages, whether they should be stopping at a pedestrian crossing, how they should overtake. If they are driving for longer hours, whether they should have rest. Sleep deprived driving is one of the main causes of deaths from lorry drivers, bus drivers. I had given a comment from about a chap. I had a chat with one of the drivers who was driving to Jaffna. He drives for 8 to 10 hours to Jaffna, sleeps for 2 hours, drives back another 10 hours. Absolute recipe for disaster. There should be laws enforcing that companies should ensure that long distance drivers do have adequate periods of rest, because they are paid by number of hours, the number of the distance they drive. These are very simple things: alcohol and driving, monotonous driving, and use of force. You can use the mass media, particularly TV. You can put simple clips day in and day out. There are 8 million vehicles. So every other family probably has got access to a vehicle one way or the other. It should be mass education on simple things is absolutely paramount in Sri Lanka. And they should be bombarded daily, so that this will drive into their brains that simple good driving behavior is paramount to prevent any disaster. Thank you.
Chairman, this is Manjula De Silva.
Yes, Manjula, go ahead.
CEO of the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce. I think we had a very good discussion with a lot of valuable suggestions coming from many people. I just want to make a couple of points. One is that I think we don't need to really debate a lot about whether it is infrastructure improvements or whether it's behavioral changes or law enforcement or what is more important than the other. I think we need of actions here. In my opinion, I think you need like some short-term actions, medium-term, and long-term. This should all come within a national action plan, so which has to be coordinated by a single agency. So this is something I think the government authorities who are present here will have to figure out who should be that one single agency who should drive this total agenda, within which I think there's a place for everything that we have spoken of today, and not that, you know, one is more important than the other. So I think it's also important to identify the causes of the accidents, in particular the fatal accidents, by further analyzing the data that is available. Now, although many people commented about the deficiency of data, I can tell you as a person who has worked in the insurance industry for a good part of my career, that there's a lot of data available with the insurance industry. And I think one can analyze that data, and from that we should be able to get a fairly good picture of what are the main causes. And if I may just also like indicate a couple of causes from sort of anecdotal experience, though I have not really analyzed the data in great detail. I mean, some of these are coming down to behavioral issues. Like now, if you take the number of people who are getting run over on pedestrian crossings, right? Now, that has nothing to do with infrastructure. I mean, that is simply reckless driving. And if you take also the number of cases where buses have gone down to precipices and off the road and caused severe accidents, it's because of people falling asleep at the wheel. So I mean, like that, I mean, you know, you can identify some of the key risk factors. I think the WHO, the doctor brought out some of these things like overspeeding, drunk and dangerous driving, helmets not worn, not wearing seat belts, and use of mobile devices. So like that, I think we can identify a few such contributory factors and which can then be dealt with to bring about some quick wins. So, I mean, at the same time, I'm not undermining the importance of infrastructure changes and improving the vehicle standards and so on. But I think we just need a multiple kind of multi-pronged approach dealing with all these issues, and where the behavioral factors are also very, very important if you really look at the causes of some of these accidents. Thank you.
Clifford, can I make a comment?
Yes, Prasanna.
So, Anu, thank you very much, everyone. I think all this basically takes us to links to a sort of a national agency, because all the, even the Q&A session, all the individuals told this. So there has to be, I think, a national agency where all these ideas, all what the various individual ministries do, and all collaborations, and then as well as government strategies, should come and be coordinated. So this is where our expert committee has been for some time sort of pushing for a presidential task force on road traffic injuries, not sort of to establish another task force, but mainly to bring everyone together under one umbrella and then sort of make them work together. So I am really, really, really happy that the Honorable Minister was sort of supportive to this idea. So we sort of think as a committee, we will go and meet him as he invited, and then get his support and get his sort of encouragement to establish this committee. Again, don't misunderstand or anything. So we, through this committee, we are not planning to initiate any new things, but actually to bring everyone together and then have a discussion and have, as again, as someone pointed out, have a national strategic plan, say, the short term, medium term, and long term, establish it, and then without sort of changing it, go till we basically reduce these crashes. So all the others are, I think, basically individual sort of opinions and ideas, all towards the reduction of crashes. So definitely each of us, including me, we think one area is more important than the other. And actually the research data also will show that area being important, but what we are not doing is we are not coming to one table and then talking with each other. So that is what actually our main plan also was at the beginning. And so because why a lot of burden was not discussed today was, we had a similar conference last year also in February before COVID started. So we didn't want to sort of have the same conference. So therefore we thought we will go a little sort of further and then have this kind of a discussion, which I think was sort of okay. And thank you very much for listening.